Hi everyone. Today we're going to be going over sedimentary rocks. So I'll be talking about the three main types of sedimentary rocks and how we classify them. Sedimentary rocks, as you can see here in this picture, are the type of rocks that contain fossils. So they're pretty awesome. So first, just to review where sedimentary rocks lie in the rock cycle, we can see that sediment from weathering and erosion of either metamorphic or igneous rocks or previously formed sedimentary rocks will form detrital sediment, which then can be compacted and cemented together, which those two terms together define lithification. And that lithification will turn that sediment back into a rock, and this rock is termed a sedimentary rock. However, you'll see in a few slides that there are other ways to form sedimentary rocks. It's not only from old sediment that has been weathered and eroded. They can also form from chemical precipitation, and we'll see that soon. Three main types of sedimentary rocks include clastic sedimentary rocks, carbonate sedimentary rocks, and non-carbonate chemical sedimentary rocks. Clastic rocks form from detrital formation. So this just means detrital sediment or loose sediment from weathering and erosion of previous rocks is detrital sediment that then gets lithified into new rocks. However, carbonates and non-carbonate chemical rocks are chemical sedimentary rocks. This just means they're non-detrital. They form from precipitation or from accumulation of carbonate material from organisms, and we'll see that soon. But first, we're going to talk about clastic sedimentary rocks. Clastic sedimentary rocks, as you can see in this animation, basically weathered material gets compacted and cemented or lithified, and this forms new rock due to burial under overlying rocks. And the classification of sedimentary rocks is done by using grain size mostly. So the grain size of shale is very, very fine. This is a sedimentary rock. Basically, we call it shale or mudstone or clay stone. And mud and clay are just terms that define grain size. Basically, they're so fine that you couldn't see it with your eyes. You would have to use a microscope. Then from there, we go up to sand-sized grains. And sand-sized grains form rocks that we call sandstone. So kept it pretty simple there. And they're a little bit bigger. You might be able to see them with your eyes. We go from there to really coarse-grained pebbles or boulders is what we use in terms of terminology there. And these pebbles and boulders can be compacted and cemented together into rocks that we call conglomerates or breccias. So I put conglomerate here because the rock in the picture has rounded out clasts, and we use clasts to describe the pebbles in this rock. And because these clasts are rounded, it's a conglomerate rock. But if the clasts were angular and looked really sharp, then the rock would be termed breccia. So to get a little bit more specific with grain size, angularity and roundness, and sorting, which I haven't discussed yet, these are all ways to classify clastic sedimentary rocks. In terms of grain size, like we talked about, we see clay or mud is the finest. Silt is in between clay and sand-sized grains. And sand can either be fine sand, medium sand, or coarse sand. And from there, we go up to granules and pebbles. And pebbles are the largest. So other than grain size, we use characteristics like rounding. Rounding, like I talked about, for example, on the conglomerate, rounding matters because we either classify it as conglomerate if the clasts are rounded, or breccia if they're angular. And this distinction gives us an idea of how the rock formed. So breccia implies that because these clasts are angular, that they haven't traveled very far or been transported very far, whereas the conglomerate implies that those clasts went through a lot of transport and weathering before they were re-cemented into the rock. And that gives us some idea of depositional environment. Furthermore, sorting is also a technique we use to understand how grains might have been transported. We do this by looking at the relative sizes of the grains. So if they're all about equal in size, then that's well sorted. And if they range a lot from, you know, say fine to coarse grain sand, and there's no pattern, they're just random, then that's poorly sorted. And this can give us an idea of how these grains were transported, meaning things like wind versus water transport, because these modes of transportation really do affect the way that grains are sorted. Okay, so carbonate rocks are the types of rocks that contain fossils most of the time, and this is because they are made up of calcium carbonate, which comes from the hard parts of a lot of marine organisms, or the skeletons. For example, mollusk shells. Mollusks are just clams and snails and stuff. Corals are carbonate material. There are tiny little unicellular algae species that have carbonate skeletons. Sponges can have carbonate skeletons. And so all these marine organisms and aquatic organisms in general that have carbonate skeletons contribute to forming carbonate rocks. And so if you want to find really cool fossils, I suggest looking into carbonate sedimentary rocks. In terms of the classification for carbonate rocks, there are two main classification schemes. Dunham's classification, which we'll talk about on this slide, and Folk's classification, which we'll talk about on the next slide. In the Dunham classification, you can see that they talk about mud-supported versus grain-supported carbonate rocks. When we say mud, we just mean something that we can't see the individual grains of. And when we say grains in terms of carbonate rocks, we mean fossil fragments typically. So are there more fragments or is there more mud? So if you can't see individual grains or fragments of anything, then you're probably looking at carbonate mud. And if you can't see any mud, all you see are grains, you have a lack of carbonate mud. And this tells us something about what type of environment that the carbonate rock formed in. For example, the presence of mud implies that the formation of this rock occurred in a low energy environment where calcite could precipitate in between grains and form a calcite cement that wasn't disturbed or washed away by further high energy waves or anything. Whereas a lack of mud indicates the formation of these rocks occurred in a high energy environment, meaning something like the swash zone of the beach where you've got waves coming in and out and it's going to only leave behind the grains and then we have minimal cement. This Dunham's classification can be used in the field to identify carbonate rocks. That's why it's really helpful, so it's not maybe as detailed as Folk's classification, but you can't use Folk's classification in the field because you would need a microscope. The reason for this is because this classification scheme is based on relative micrite versus sphericalcite composition. So micrite is a carbonate mud matrix or cement that is really fine grain and it forms in low energy environments, whereas sphericalcite is a coarser grained calcitic cement that forms due to alteration of the original micrite cement. And this alteration occurs in higher energy environments. So sphericalcite is typically an indication of recrystallization of the micrite. However, you can't distinguish between the micrite and the sphericalcite if you don't use a microscope. And then grains are used in the same way as Dunham's classification, in which they just mean any fossil fragments. And these grains and their abundances are only considered after you have determined relative micrite and sphericalcite concentrations in the rock. And then you can use grain to further classify them using Folk's classification. Moving on now to non-carbonate chemical sedimentary rocks, we're going to be talking about evaporites. There are some other chemical sedimentary rocks that are non-carbonates, such as coal and banded iron formations, which we'll talk a lot about in another episode. But for now, we're just going to be focusing on evaporites, which are the main other type of chemical sedimentary rock that are not carbonates. These rocks are not carbonates because they don't have a carbonate group in their composition. Typically, evaporites are either sulfates or halides. Halides are basically salts, and evaporites form from precipitation directly from solution due to an evaporative environment. So say you have a lake environment that is subjected to frequent evaporation, like the Great Salt Lake. And this evaporation causes increased precipitation of salts and other evaporite rocks because the concentrations of these dissolved ions are getting so high in solution that they have to precipitate out the more evaporation occurs. And this precipitation of evaporite rocks occurs in an order based on solubility. So the first evaporites to precipitate out of the solution are gypsum and anhydrite. And these are the sulfate minerals we talked about. And then further evaporation will cause halite and then sylvite to precipitate out in that order. And that is because the solubility of salt is higher. And so they'll stay dissolved for longer. to recap, we went over the three main types of sedimentary rocks, how they form, and how we classify them. Next time, we'll be talking about metamorphic rocks, and I can't wait to see you guys there.